After the Minnesota Timberwolves made the playoffs 2 seasons ago, it was supposed to be a sign of things to come. They had traded for an all-star in Jimmy Butler, and they felt they had the foundation of a playoff contender moving forward. But that optimism was short-lived, as there were rumblings that Jimmy Butler didn't want to stay in Minnesota long-term. But the head coach Tom Thibodeau, who was also president of basketball operations, did not want to trade Butler. Thibodeau's mindset was win now. Butler acted like he was desperate to leave the team, and he had issues with the two youngest stars on the team and didn't believe they had what it takes to be winners. Jimmy Butler hijacked the whole offseason and the start of the season for the Minnesota Timberwolves. Everybody knows the story of Jimmy Butler showing his frustration during practice, and there was a report that he led a bunch of third stringers and beat the starters. It was clear. Andrew Wiggins and Karl-Anthony Towns didn't want to play with Jimmy Butler, and Jimmy Butler didn't want to play with them. Whether he's right about the young guys or not, Butler has had a track record of having problems with his teammates in his career. At some point, the blame should fall on him if this becomes more of a trend. They started the season without a trade, and the Timberwolves played like a team that was broken. You didn't know if Jimmy Butler was going to sit out with an injury or if he was going to play 40 minutes. But eventually the team did what they had to do as they traded Jimmy Butler to the 76ers for Robert Covington, Dario Saric, and a second round pick. Not the best deal, but what can you expect for a guy on the last year of his contract, and everybody knows he wanted to be traded. And at 19-21 on January 6th, after a 22-point win against the Lakers, Tom Thibodeau was fired halfway in the season. Once Butler was out the door, the writing was already on the wall for Tom Thibodeau. As it stands right now, Robert Covington is the second best player on the team. His impact far exceeds any other current player on the roster besides Karl-Anthony Towns. He's the classic 3-and-D player. He's always been known for his play on the defensive end. Despite only playing 35 games between the 76ers and the Timberwolves, Covington finished in first place in defensive real plus minus among small forwards. Minnesota was 12-10 when Covington was in the lineup, and in his first 8 games in Minnesota, the team did not give up more than 103 points in the game, going 6-2. If players like him, Derrick Rose, and Jeff Teague could have stayed healthy, Minnesota could have possibly been in the race for the playoffs late in the season. Covington suffered a bone bruise in his knee on New Year's Eve that cost him the rest of the season. After having issues with Jimmy Butler, and once that dark cloud went away, Karl-Anthony Towns showed how good of a player he really is. We know what kind of offensive player he is at this point of his career. But surprisingly, he showed some improvement on the defensive end. He still has a long way to go, but he is not as bad as he was 2 years ago. Ryan Saunders took over as head coach, and he played a big part in the big numbers that Towns had in the second half of the season. Saunders made sure that Towns got more touches on offense. Towns made the All-Star team for the second consecutive season. He played much harder after the trade went down. Butler was probably the main motivation for his improvement last season. If that's what it takes for him to get better, then so be it. He still needs to improve on defense and keeping his teammates involved on offense. Nobody is expecting Andrew Wiggins to all of a sudden turn into a star player that his contract warrants. It's incredible how little he has improved since coming into the league. The same weaknesses he had 3 years ago are the same weaknesses he has today. And the Timberwolves jumped the gun and gave him a max extension, mostly because he was a former first overall pick, and Minnesota is a team that doesn't necessarily attract free agents. At the very least, Wiggins can score the ball, but he is not efficient, and at times he looks lazy and isn't a good defender. At this point, you just hope he becomes a more efficient scorer. The Timberwolves are just counting down the days when he becomes a free agent. The team is just hoping that players like Jarrett, Culver, and Josh Okogie can develop into all-around players they need on the wing. The Timberwolves traded up in the draft from 11 to 6 to draft the sophomore out of Texas Tech, Jarrett Culver. He is coming off a season where he showed massive improvements from his freshman year, as he averaged 18 points, 6 rebounds, 4 assists, and 1.5 steals per game in his sophomore season. He has the work ethic that you can only dream of for Andrew Wiggins. Culver has improved as a scorer, defender, and passer. At 6'7", Culver is a strong player and can develop into a solid post player. He will need to be a more consistent jump shooter and tighten up his ball handling. Him or Josh Okogie could be taking Wiggins' spot in no time. Okogie was the team's first round pick from last year. He showed off his athleticism and defense in his rookie year. The way he played on defense, you would have thought he has been in the league for a number of years. He showed what kind of defender he could be when he gave James Harden some problems with this amazing shot block on his jump shot. He brings constant energy off the bench and it rubs off on his teammates. Okogie might not have had the best season on the offensive end, but he showed his value in other areas of his game. With more improvements on his jump shot and more minutes, he will look to make a bigger jump in his game in his sophomore season. The Timberwolves also added players like Noah Vonleh, Jake Layman, and Jordan Bell in the offseason. I believe adding a player like Vonleh was an underrated move. Vonleh was able to showcase more of his skill set last season with the New York Knicks. He enjoyed his best NBA season as he averaged around 8 points, 8 rebounds, and shot 47% from the field and 33% from three-point range. Vonleh is on his 15th in 6 seasons. He feels it's time for him to start playing up to his potential and play like a lottery pick. He will bring size, rebounding, and versatility to the Timberwolves on both ends of the court. He's in line to play a big role in the front court next to the two-time All-Star Karl-Anthony Towns. I expect Coach Saunders to ask Vonleh to be more aggressive on the offensive end and put more pressure on opposing big men with his quickness and athleticism. Vonleh often flashed his 37-inch vertical last season as he had a number of putback dunks and was able to posterize a couple of players every once in a while. He still has a chance to be a more impactful player and become a key cog to a playoff team. Jeff Teague has been a solid point guard for the Timberwolves and should continue to provide a solid impact on offense and defense. He will be on the last year of his contract and more than likely won't be back with the team next summer. Ryan Saunders will hope to change the culture in Minnesota and begin to build a winning team. If this team can stay healthy, they could be competitive for much of the season, but they don't have enough just yet to fight for a playoff spot. I have the Timberwolves winning 30 games and finishing in 12th place in the Western Conference. Karl-Anthony Towns should continue to be the franchise player the team needs and continue to improve his weaknesses. Robert Covington, Jarrett Culver, and Josh Okogie are the other players to feel good about for the future of the team. It will take some time for this team to build that winning culture, but it looks like they have the right coach and players to start building towards a playoff team in the future.